Welcome dear student and Jai Swaminarayan. In the first video of the chapter number 9, we were discuss about the elasticity property of the material or elasticity property of solid. What do you mean by the elasticity? When we apply a deforming force on the body, the dimension of the body will change, right? And when we remove the deforming force, apply the deforming force on the body will retain its original position. This property of the solid is called the elasticity property. The property of the material by which the body will regain its original position, the body will try to retain its original position, this property is known as the elasticity property. So when we applying the deforming force, the dimension of the body like length, volume, shape of the body will change, or we can say that the size of the body will change. The physical quantity associated with this statement is called the strain. So the change in the dimension can be measured with the physical quantity strain, right? And when we remove the applied force, the body will try to regain its original position because of the restoring force produced in the body. And the physical quantity associated with the statement is stress, right? The physical quantity associated with the restoring force is a stress. So in this video, we will discuss about the strain and stress, right? So when we apply a deforming force on the body, the dimension of the body will change, and when we remove the deforming force, the body will regain its original position. So this property is called the elasticity property, and the physical quantity associated with this elasticity property of the solid is a strain and strain. So in this video, we will discuss about the strain. What do you mean by the strain? What are the types of the strain? And stress, what do you mean by the stress? And what are the types of the stress? So dear student, let us start with the strain. Dear student, we know that when the deforming force is applied on the body, the dimension of the body like a length, volume and shape will be changed, right? So when we apply the deforming force on a body, the dimension of the body will change, and corresponding physical quantity that measures the change in the dimension of the body is called the strain. The ratio of change in the dimension to the original dimension is called the strain, right? So here the ratio of change in the dimension to the original dimension is called the strain. So strain is defined as the ratio of change in dimension to the original dimension. So strain is equal to change in the dimension divided by original dimension. So from that is the dimension, change in the dimension to the dimension. So strain is a unitless physical quantity, right? So which type of the dimension, length of the body change, volume of the body change, or shape of the body will change, the strain is classified into three types. First, length, second, volume, and third, shape, right? So longitudinal strain, right, volume strain, and the shearing strain. So first we consider the length, right? So when the deforming force is applied on the body, perpendicular to the body, the length of the body will change, right? So the strain associated with the length of the body, that is called the longitudinal strain, or longitudinal strain. So the longitudinal strain is defined as the ratio of change in the length to the original length. Longitudinal strain is denoted by epsilon L. So here epsilon is for the strain and L for the length. So strain is defined as the change in the dimension to the original dimension. Strain is a unitless physical quantity, dimensionless quantity. According to that, which dimension is changed, the strain is classified into the three types, right? First, according to the length, longitudinal strain, according to the volume, volume strain, and according to the shape of the body will change the shearing strain. So first we consider the longitudinal strain. So the longitudinal strain is defined as the ratio of change in the length, increase in the length or decrease in the length, change in the length to the original length. So longitudinal strain is denoted by sigma L, right, is equal to change in the length delta L divided by original length. So for example, let us consider the elastic rod of a original length L and tied up one end of the elastic rod with the rigid support. On the free end of the elastic rod, suppose we applying a tension force F, right? So length of the rod be increased by a delta L. So here L is the original length, right? And increase in the length or change in the length is a delta L. So the longitudinal strain sigma L is defined as the ratio of the change in the length delta L to the original length, right? So this type of the question may be asked in your examination. Suppose the 10 Newton force is applied on the cylindrical rod and the length of the rod is increased by 2 mm. Calculate the longitudinal strain. So this type of the question may be asked in your examination. So dear student, you must have to remember the formula of the longitudinal strain. So longitudinal strain is defined as the change in the length to the original length, right? So for that, consider a cylindrical rod of a length L or consider a wire of a original length L tied with the one end of the wire at the rigid support, and a force F is applied at the free end of the rigid support. If the length of the wire is increased by a delta L, the longitudinal strain sigma L is equal to delta L by L, right? Longitudinal strain is also a dimensionless physical quantity because it is the ratio of the change in length to the original length. Now, dear student, if we applying a deforming force, right, the length of the body may be increased or decreased. So according to that, the longitudinal strain is further classified into two categories, tensile strain and compressive strain. So first one, if the deforming force is applied and the length of the body is increased, the longitudinal strain is called the tensile strain. And if the deforming force is applied and the length of the body is decreased, the longitudinal strain is called the compressive strain. So dear student, understand about the longitudinal strain. What do you mean by the longitudinal strain? Longitudinal strain is defined as the ratio of change in the length to the original length. Longitudinal strain and all the type of the strain is a dimensionless physical quantity. Longitudinal strain can be classified in two categories, right? There are two types of the longitudinal strain, tensile strain and the compressive strain, right? So the formula of the longitudinal strain is a change in the length divided by original length. And if the length of the body is increases, the longitudinal strain is called the tensile strain. And if the length of the body is decreases, the longitudinal strain is called the compressive strain. Now, next physical quantity is the volume. When we applying a deforming force on the body, and if the volume of the body is changed, the change in the volume to the original volume is called the volume strain, right? So how the volume of the body is changed? So for that, consider a elastic cube like this, and when we applying a deforming force, in perpendicular to the all the surface of the elastic cube, right, the volume of the cube will change, right? So when the deforming force is applied to the body perpendicular to the surface of the body, the volume of the body will change and the volume strain is produced in the body, right? So volume strain is defined as the ratio of the change in the volume to the original volume, right? So the ratio of change in the volume to the original volume is called the volume strain. Volume strain is also a ratio of the two similar physical quantities. So the volume strain is also a dimensionless physical quantity. So for that, consider a elastic cube of a volume capital V. Original volume of the elastic cube is a capital V. If the length of the cube is given to you, we can easily calculate the volume. If the rectangular slab is given to you, we can easily calculate the original volume with that dimension. So when we applying the deforming force perpendicular to the surface of the cube, the volume of the cube is decreases, right? So the change in the volume, let us consider the change in the volume is a delta V, right? So the volume strain EV, that is the epsilon V, it is equal to delta V by V, right? So here, when the force is applied on the body, the volume strain, that volume of the body is changes, right? It may be increased, it may be decreased. And the change in the volume delta V divided by original volume V, that is called the volume strain, right? So understand here, student, volume strain. Now next one is the shape. So when we applying the deforming force on the body, right, if the shape of the body is changes, the corresponding strain is called the shearing strain, or we can say that the tangential strain, right? So for that, we have to apply the deforming force parallel to the surface in the direction of the tangent, right? So when the deforming force is applied to the body to the surface or the tangential direction, in the tangential direction to the surface, the shape of the body will change. Now what is the definition of the shearing strain? Corresponding strain, when the shape of the body will change, the corresponding strain is called the shearing strain. Now what is the definition of the shearing strain? Change in the shape divided by original shape, right? No, right? Unlike a length and volume, the shape of the body cannot be measured. So for that, we measure a angle of the displacement of the original point. Suppose we consider this square ABCD, right? And suppose the length of the square ABCD be a x, right? Now when we applying a tangential force to the surface parallel to the ABCD, it's a displacement. The point A is displaced to the A dash and point B is displaced to the B dash. So it makes the angle with the vertical, this angle theta, and this tangent of this angle theta is called the shearing strain. So the tangent of the angle made by the displacement of the surface is called the shearing strain. So shearing strain is equal to the tangent of this angle theta, that is the tan theta. So shearing strain epsilon s, it is equal to tan theta. Now from this figure, we can also calculate the displacement delta x and the original length x. So ratio of the displacement of the surface to the original length x, that is called the shearing strain. So dear student, I hope that you understand what do you mean by the strain and what are the types of the strain, right? The strain is defined as the ratio of the change in the dimension to the original dimension. When we apply the deforming force, the dimension of the body will change, and the change in ratio of the change in the dimension to the original dimension is called the strain. According to that, which dimension is changed? The strain is classified into the three types: longitudinal strain, volume strain, and shearing strain. Right? When we apply the deforming force, if the length of the body will change, the longitudinal strain is produced in the body. If the volume of the body will change, right, the corresponding strain produced in the body is called the volume strain. And if the shape of the body is changes, the corresponding strain produced in the body is the shearing strain. Right? So now, dear student, we will discuss about the second physical quantity. So when the deforming force is removed, when we apply the deforming force, the dimension of the body will change. But when we remove the deforming force, the body will try to retain its original position. Why? Because of the restoring force produced in the body, right? And the restoring force produced in the body per unit cross section area is called the stress, right? So let us start with the stress. What do you mean by the stress, right? So when the deforming force is removed, the body will retain its original position because of the elasticity property. Because of the elasticity property, the restoring force produced in the body, and this restoring force try to retain the body in its original position. Now, when the deforming force is applied to the body, the same amount of the restoring force produced in the body in the opposite direction of the external deforming force, right? So when the deforming force is applied to the body, same amount of the restoring force produced in the body in the opposite direction of the external force, right? And the restoring force produced in the body per unit cross section area is called the stress. So dear student, remember this: stress is defined as the restoring force per unit area. So what is the formula of the stress? The formula of the stress sigma, it is equal to restoring force divided by area. So understand, what do you mean by the stress? Stress is defined as the restoring force produced in a body per unit cross section area. So here, not only the area, it is the cross section area. For the different cross section area, the stress will be different, right? So stress sigma, it is equal to the restoring force divided by cross section area. Now in the equilibrium condition, the restoring force is equal to the external force. So to calculate the stress produced in the body, we use the external force, right? Because in the equilibrium condition, the restoring force is equal to the external force. So from this, if we consider the restoring force produced in the body is the F, the stress sigma is equal to F by A. So from that, the unit of the stress, SI unit of the stress, is Newton per meter square or a Pascal. The unit of the stress and pressure is a same, but these two are the different physical quantity, right? The difference between the stress and pressure we will discuss later on, right? But here the SI unit of the stress is a Newton per meter square, or we can say that the Pascal also. The dimensional formula of the stress is a M1 L minus 1 T minus 2, right? Here the unit, SI unit of the stress and pressure are same, but stress and pressure are the two different physical quantity. Pressure is the, when we applying the force on the body, the external force divided by area, that is called the pressure. But here the restoring force produced in the body per unit cross section area is called the strain. So like a strain, there are three types of the strain. There are three types of the stress: longitudinal stress, volume stress, and the tensile stress, or we can say that the shearing stress, right? So here, longitudinal stress, what do you mean by the longitudinal stress? When the deforming force is applied to a body and if the length of the body will change, the corresponding restoring force produced in the body per unit cross section area is called the longitudinal stress, right? So when the deforming force is applied and if the length of the body is increases, the stress is called the tensile stress. And when the deforming force is applied on the body and if the length of the body is decreases, the corresponding stress produced in the body is called the compressive stress. Right? Understand? So understand, dear student, what do you mean by the longitudinal stress? Right? Similarly, volume stress is there. Right? So when the deforming force is applied to the body and the perpendicular to the surface of the body, if the volume of the body changes, the restoring force produced per unit cross section area of the body is called the volume stress. So for that, consider a elastic cube is placed in a fluid or a liquid. So when we place a body in a fluid, the pressure is applied to the surface of the body in all the direction, and due to this pressure, the force is acting on the surface of the body, and this force produces the restoring force in the body. So here the restoring force produced per unit cross section area of the body is called the volume stress. So here, when we place a body in a fluid, the pressure is applied to the all the surface of the body equal, right? So due to this pressure, the force is, deforming force is acting on the body. And by the definition of the pressure, P is equal to force divided by area, the deforming force acting on the body, F is equal to P into A, right? So same amount of the restoring force is produced in the body, restoring force produced in the body, Fr is equal to pressure applied on the surface of the body into the cross-section area. So the volume stress is defined as this restoring force per unit area. So restoring force divided by area. So the volume stress sigma V, it is equal to restoring force, that is the P into A, divided by cross-section area A. So here, in case of the, when we place a body on the fluid, the volume stress produced on the body is same as a pressure exerted on the body due to the fluids, right? So volume strain is the same as the pressure exerted on the body in the fluid. So here, understand? So volume stress is the one type of the pressure exerted on the body in the fluid. Now, dear student, last one is the shearing stress. When the deforming force is applied to a body in the tangential to the surface, the tangential force produced in the body. So due to the tangential force, the restoring force produced in the body and per unit area is called the tangential stress, or we can say the shearing stress. So here, dear student, when the deforming force is applied to the body in the direction tangent to the surface, the tangential force produced in the body and the restoring force produced in the body, which is equal to the external force, that is the tangential force, per unit cross-section area is called the tangential stress. So, or we can say that the shearing stress. So, shearing stress produced in the body calculated by shearing stress sigma S is equal to tangential force divided by cross-section area of the surface on which we applied the tangential force. So shearing stress is equal to tangential force per unit cross section area. Sigma S, that is the shearing stress, is equal to tangential force Ft divided by cross section area A. Right? So understand all the three types of the stress and the strain is produced in the body. So dear student, when the deforming force is applied on the body, length of the body is changed, volume of the body is changed, and shape of the body is changed, and corresponding stress and strain is produced in the body. Longitudinal stress produced, volume stress produced, shearing stress is produced in the body. So how the shearing stress is produced, in which type the shearing stress is produced, longitudinal stress is produced. So for that, let us consider important points, right? you must have to remember to calculate the longitudinal stress, volume stress, tensile stress, right? And then tangential stress, right? So here, first point is that when the deforming force is applied to the body, corresponding stress and strain is produced in the body, right? So when we apply the deforming force perpendicular to the cross section area, the volume stress, longitudinal stress and longitudinal stress is produced. Is the volume of the body change? Yes, the volume of the body also change, right? So corresponding volume strain and the volume stress is produced in the body. So dear student, when we applied the deforming force perpendicular to the any cross section area, the longitudinal strain and longitudinal stress is produced. Also, the volume strain and the volume stress is produced. So what amount of the, when we applying the deforming force perpendicular, if the length of the body is increased by a delta L, what amount of the change in the volume we will see later on in this chapter, right? Next point is this important. When the deforming force applied on the body is not perpendicular to the cross section area, right? So if you considering a deforming force is at an angle theta with the horizontal, right? So due to this type of the deforming force has a two component, F cos theta component, which is perpendicular component to the surface, and F sin theta component, which is the tangential component to the surface. So due to the perpendicular component of the force F cos theta, the longitudinal stress and the longitudinal strain is produced. So strain we can calculate by change in length to the original length, but the longitudinal strain, to calculate the longitudinal strain, we take the only the perpendicular component of the force F cos theta divided by cross section area A, and due to F sin theta component, right? F sin theta component is tangential to the surface, and due to this the tangential stress is produced. So due to the tangential component, to calculate the tangential stress, we only use the F sin theta component. To calculate the longitudinal stress, we only take the perpendicular component of the force, or the component of the force which is perpendicular to the surface, right? And to calculate the tangential stress, we take the component parallel to the surface, right? Or the component of the force in the direction tangential to the surface, right? So understand, dear students. So how we can calculate the longitudinal stress and the tangential stress? Now, third point is that if here the stress is depends on the cross section area. For the different cross section area, the stress will be different. If we consider the cross section area is not a perpendicular, it is at an angle. The area vector makes an angle theta with the horizontal. So longitudinal stress is equal to force divided by A cos theta, that is the component of the area in the direction of the force. And tangential stress is calculated by taking the component of the area vector in the direction to the tangent of the force, right? So for that, we take a simple example, right? Here the elastic rod is given to you, right? Find the tangential stress and longitudinal stress in the cross section area QR. Cross section area QR is at an angle 30 degree with the perpendicular cross section PR. Here the cross section area of PQ is given to you 10 cm square, and force applied to the rod is the 10 Newton. So how we can calculate the tangential stress and the longitudinal stress? So longitudinal stress in the cross section PQ is force divided by area, simply by a force by area, because here PQ area is the area vector of the PQ is in the direction of the force, right? So longitudinal stress in cross section area PQ we calculate by only sigma is equal to force by area. Here the force and area both are in the same direction, but if you want to calculate the longitudinal stress in the direction in the cross section QR, we take a component of the area vector, right? So cos 30 is equal to PQ by QR. So QR is equal to PQ by cos 30. Value of the cos 30 is the 10 by root 3 by 2. So 10 divided by root 3 by 2, and it is equal to 20 by root 3 cross into 10 raised to minus 4 meter square. So cross section area QR is equal to 20 by root 3 into 10 raised to minus 4. So longitudinal stress can be calculated by F by A cos theta, because A cos theta is the perpendicular component towards the force, right? So, and the tangential stress is calculated by F divided by A sin theta. Here A sin theta is the component of the area vector in the direction towards the tangent of the cross section area, right? So this may be asked in your examination like this: to calculate the longitudinal stress, to calculate the tensile stress, you must have to remember the how we can calculate the longitudinal stress and how we can calculate the tangential stress. So dear student, I hope that you understand all the types of the stress and all the type of the strain. How we can calculate the strain, how we can calculate the stress, right? Thank you very much for watching my video.